Welcome to 2021. This is series 3 of the UK Thrashers radio show. Let's kick things off with some Trapped in Purgatory. This is Demonicide. In Purgatory, they are coming up in the show for an interview in a couple of songs' time. Okay, next up is Killanova. This is their latest single, Immortal.
Lost.
Okay, that was Newcastle's Killanova. Next up, from Oldham, this is A Knee to the Face of Corruption, the latest single from Tortured Demon. We'll be right back. Ah, those noisy young fuckers from Oldham. That's Tortured Demon, and they'll be on the show in the next few weeks. Okay, this week, it's our interview with Trapped in Purgatory. Okay, welcome to the latest episode of the UK... I'll start that again. Welcome to the latest episode of the UK Thrashers Radio Show. This week in the studio, we've got Trapped in Purgatory. Welcome to the show, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, Neil. Nice to not see you.
Do you want to do an introduction and also introduce what you do in the band and introduce your missing members as well?
Yeah, my name's John. I'm the bass player from Trapped in Purgatory. I do some other stuff as well, but... yeah, that's additional. But yeah, Jock and Jason are our guitarists, and Mark on drums, and yourself, Chris, on vocals.
Hello. Yes, indeed. Chris Neighbour, vocals and lyrics.
Excellent. So for those who don't know, do you want to explain a little bit about the band and the kind of the heritage you've got? You know, obviously it's a new band, but the roots of the band go back a long way. Do you want to kind of give a little backstory on where you guys have come from?
Yeah, so Jason and Jock and myself, we used to be in a thrash band in the 80s called Purgatory around the Bristol area alongside a couple of other chaps called Daryl and Bernie. And it was good, you know, it was a good time to be in a thrash band. It was what I refer to as the first wave of UK thrash around 87, 88. So because there wasn't many bands doing that, you know, we got quite a lot of... quite a lot of exposure and a lot of gigs, and when we played quite a lot with Onslaught and people like that, but it was very short, so it burnt out after about two or three years. So I went on to do some other things, and so did Jock, and then sort of Purgatory kind of just sort of drifted into the history books, and then about 4 or 5 years ago I got an email from someone saying there was this little record label trying to hunt the band down because they wanted to release a load of the old demos and stuff. Obviously, the resurgence of thrash in recent years, I mean, it's always been there, but, you know, there's been a massive influx, particularly of the old school styling of thrash. So there was a big interest from overseas for the UK stuff, you know. So anyway, this label, they found us and we had a chat, and it was really nice because it gave an opportunity for me and the rest of the guys to hook up, which we hadn't spoken for years, you know. One of them was living in Australia, another one was in New Zealand. A couple of them hadn't done any music at all. As I say, a couple of us had. So we hooked up and we went back into the original recording studio, which was White House Studios in Weston-super-Mare. And we remastered and remixed all the old Purgatory stuff. And bung it out on an album, and it got received quite well. And at the time, the label said, "Look, do you want to do any new material?" And we were like, "Well, there's no way logistically we can get it together." So we just kind of shelved it. Anyway, fast forward about 4 or 5 years, Jason just texts me out of the blue, went, "Chris, man," that's how he talks, "Chris, man, do you fancy doing something then?" So he goes, "Look, do you fancy doing some writing?" So I put the feelers out, and it just felt right, you know, because if he'd asked me 18 months beforehand, I would have said no. I wasn't in a place in my life where I wanted to do music again at all. I hadn't been in a band for 10 years. So we just sort of asked the rest of the guys, and it became pretty clear pretty quickly that Daryl and Bernie wouldn't be able to do it logistically, being literally across other continents. So we kind of thought, well, okay, well, who are we going to get as the rhythm section? Now, Mark on drums, he'd actually been a drummer in Four Way Kill, my last band, for a while. And I knew he wasn't in a band at the time. So we contacted him. And then we were sort of thinking of bass players. And John and I, we've known each other for many years, having gigged with Four Way Kill and Mercury Rain, and just been part of the same scene, you know. So his name came out. Now, I knew John was a bit of a workaholic. I knew his abilities. I knew his love for music and his love for recording and mixing. So it was a no-brainer, really. And so the conversation was had. I sent out a few text messages. This is going on for fucking ever, isn't it? So we thought, well, rather than just call it Purgatory, because it's not so much of a reformation, it's more of a reinvention, Trapped in Purgatory, because we stole the name Purgatory from a Slayer song anyway. So we thought, well, Trapped in Purgatory kind of sums it up. We're still doing it. You know, we're all past our mid-40s, and here we are still fucking doing it, Trapped in Purgatory. So it just seemed like an apt name. The initial idea was to do an EP. I was really glad when we sort of decided to carry on writing, and it turned into an album.
I think you insisted on it, Chris, from memory.
Oh, he's back. Did I? Yeah, there was, yeah, was quite a bit to and fro, wasn't it?
You kept
writing. Yeah, anyway, about the EP, I didn't mean LP.
Because I knew what was ahead, mate. I knew what was coming.
Yeah, how about we have 10 short songs? So the album, I mean, John, do you want to add anything to that, the more recent?
Sorry, I missed a big chunk of it. Last time I heard, you're in Western still.
God, a lot's happened there, mate.
I mean, funny enough, we supported you guys at the Scottish Horn Centre in Nailsy back in, what, 89?
Oh, God, I forgot that. Yes, indeed.
Exactly. So we had kind of, that's where I knew you from. And then we kind of parted ways. And the next thing I know, you know, we were playing Bloodstock together in, what, 2003?
2003, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I was in a band called Mercury Rain, you know, sort of the female-fronted symphonic stuff. Yeah, and we did a few shows together and stuff, completely mismatched, but what the hell. And then
John put on a couple of festivals and I kept blagging passes for it.
Yeah, yeah, that's true.
And the pretext I was doing a review.
Yeah.
did you ever see any of them, John? Did they ever arrive?
No, I think we all know what was really happening. We supported Therion, the Swedish metal band. We supported them in France and stuff. Yeah, I did quite a bit of them. And then, yeah, for years I'd done nothing. And then, yeah, this text popped in out of the blue. And I thought, you know what? That's perfect. I'm up for a project. Hmm. Let's do it.
And kind of coming back to thrash again, obviously you kind of both gone and done, you know, other genres of metal from the sound of it during the period of time. You know, did you just think it was the time was right to come back with thrash because of that big resurgence, you know, and looking at the scene and seeing, you know, your Acid Rains and your Viruses and your Onslaught still being kind of credible, I guess, for want of a better term?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think playing thrash is so much fun anyway, you know, it's such a high energy genre of music. And also being our age as well, I think, you know, I still like singers, you know, and what I like about thrash, you get a lot of singers. And I love that sort of frenetic energy in thrash. And if I'm honest, you know, the last band I was in, it was heavy. It was heavy as fuck, but it was never quite thrashy enough for me. And I think if you look at what Jay Walsh done afterwards with Bull Riff, I don't think it was ever thrashy enough for him either. So I think, yeah, I mean, the idea was originally with Trapped in Purgatory was to keep it really quite thrashy and hardcore. In fact, it's become a lot more melodic than we expected. because I think, is that you coughing, John?
Yeah, it might be, yeah.
Because, I mean, we just felt, you know, we like big choruses. It's got to be catchy. John, John's got a nickname at the moment. He's the melody maker. Because the rest of the guys would just write these relentless thrash riffs. And then I go, John, you've got to sprinkle a bit of silver on this, mate. So I think the whole thrash thing, I've always felt a real connection to thrash metal, as I say. You know, I always consider my personal, you know, choice of music genre is always traditional heavy metal and thrash. You know, I just think it was such a natural step from what I was listening to at the time. You know, I grew up on Diamond Head and Tigers of Pantang and Iron Maiden and Accept and Priest and bands like that. So then when Metallica came out and Anthrax and Testament and Exodus and all these bands, it was a natural progression to me in heavy metal music. So even though this, you know, we're kind of using the term thrash a lot with this new album, and, you know, people like yourselves are actually welcoming that and we appreciate that. You know, to me, it's just another metal album because, you know, I love thrash metal, and this is just a natural expression, I think.
I think
where we're at.
The thrash moniker is a lot wider now than it ever was.
Yeah,
I think in 1988, you know, our vision of what thrash was pretty limited, wasn't it? You know, whereas there's lots more space. Probably gone too far the other way, and there's so many subgenres of every music type. You can end up down a bit of a wormhole if you're not careful.
Yeah, I think you've just got to play music you like. Otherwise, your heart's not in it. You've got to enjoy it. And if other people enjoy it, then that's great.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I was watching an interview with Jeff from Annihilator. And he said similar, you know, he was going, he said, look, he goes, you know, he goes, I'm an old man. He goes, he said, I only know one type of music, and that's metal music.
Although they've experimented probably more than anyone, haven't they? You know, you go through Annihilator's back catalogue, and there's some, you know, it's not all Alice in Hell and Never Neverland. There's some definite off-piece stuff in the middle until, you know, this year, end of last year, they came back with, you know, something that could have been released in 1990.
Absolutely. And I think a lot of bands did that. You've only got to look back. Because for me, you know, thrash got a bit pedestrian for me in the 90s. A couple of the big boys were still doing good stuff, Megadeth particularly. But, you know, I went right off Metallica, and even like Testament and Exodus were sort of experimenting with trying to be a bit more commercial. And it kind of put me off because it lost that sort of gnarly kind of spoilt brat sort of attitude that thrash always had. And I suppose that's one challenge we've got is sort of trying to not recapture, but trying to hold on to that kind of sort of like, yeah, snarly sort of fuck you attitude, being middle-aged blokes, you know, still keeping that fire.
Do you think that sometimes makes it easier though? Because obviously you're at a position in your life that, you know, when you were, you know, 18, 19 and, you know, you were, you know, struggling to pay the rent and all that sort of stuff.
I still am.
Well, John's not. John's living the lap of luxury with.
It's called marrying well.
Marrying above your station. Yeah. do you think that takes a little bit of the pressure off though? You know, you're a bit more confident in yourself, and you're not chasing that rainbow anymore.
I'd say. I mean, when you're 18, 19, you've got something to prove. You know. Mm. You know, you want to go out and you want to be the best, this, that, and the other. When you get a bit older, you suddenly realize why all these bands have breaks for 20 years. They go in, have kids and have a career and work and stuff, and then they miss it and they come back and do it again. And it is different. You know, everyone's got different pressures. Everyone's got different stuff they have to do. But, yeah, you know, we still take it incredibly seriously, and we still are really proud of what we've done, and we want people to like it. And it hurts when someone says, no, it's shit. Yeah. Not that anyone's done that yet.
Not yet.
No. Always caveat that.
That's it. So, what have you? You know, obviously, having, you know, saying about a 10-year break between, do you see a big change in the industry as it was then? And obviously, you know, the digital side of it is massively different. But
let's face it, the thing that's changed everything is the internet, isn't it? I mean, you know,
it was still tape trading when I was last doing it.
but yeah, I mean, when I was rehearsing, you know, with bands back in the 90s and stuff, I mean, you were only in Bristol, really. And that was it. You couldn't get beyond, you know, the geographical boundaries and stuff. Yeah, now you can speak to anyone in the world. You can send them an MP3 and they've got your stuff. Job done. It's amazing.
I think without the sort of current technology, we wouldn't have been able to get this album out, certainly. No. And it's been a completely eye-opening experience for me and for, I think, most of us. Just the fact that it's like we can record this album and live miles apart, and it's just like, how does that work? You know, write a song and send it MP3s to each other. You know, we recorded the drums, you know, John was recording the drums in a completely different town to where they were being played. You know, that just, you couldn't do that 10 years ago.
I was going to ask you about the recording process. So you guys, there was no studio, or at least no one group of you all in the same studio.
We spent about a year, Chris, sort of rehearsing and stuff and writing songs. And, you know, because we all live a little bit further away and stuff, just getting together was... We found that we were forgetting stuff. We weren't really moving on quick enough, certainly for me. So I said, look, why don't we do it the way I know how to do it? I've done it in the past, and we'll do it digitally, and we'll just work the songs up. It'd be like the world's slowest jam, but I know it'll work. And that's what we did. So we started basically, you know, compiling the songs and rewriting and stuff. And I don't think it fell out over any bits, but yeah, certainly a lot of intense discussions. Do you agree with that, Chris? It was a different process to you. I said, look, if we go into a rehearsal studio for a weekend, lay all the drums down, it's gonna be a waste of time. It's gonna cost us a lot of money. We're not gonna be happy with the sound, and we're gonna want to change bits after, and we won't be able to do that. Mm. You know. Mark went out and spent a lot of money on an electronic drum kit, and yeah, job done.
Don't say that.
Sorry, can we edit that out?
Fucking heathen.
to be honest, there's plenty of, you know, sometimes these days with the editing process, the real drummer gets, you know, wiped out by the overdubs anyway. So you kind of lost him, you lose him in the mix anyway.
Yeah. Sorry, my personal preference, because I am very old school. I would have loved to have just carried on, just sort of bashing out in the rehearsal studio. Because the one thing I found that I missed was just not being able to try vocal ideas out. So a lot of the melodies for the album and the vocal deliveries were all done in my head, basically. And it was only when John and I got together to actually record the vocals that I realised that some worked and some didn't. Some bits were added, some bits were cut out. So I think when you can rehearse, and also when you can gig an album as well before you can record it, you get to know the song better. And sometimes you can learn what's gonna stay and what's gonna go. So I think because of that, in a sense, I think we've done really well, because, as I say, we've gone in cold really with the vocals, which I've never done before. But also, you know, there's been a lot of pressure lifted with timescale wise, just bouncing it to and fro, like John said, and doing it remotely. It has taken longer, but there's been no pressure. No one's been breathing down our neck. There's been no like, fuck, we've paid for the studio. We got 4 days to get this done and then we got to get out. There's been none of that. So that's been quite nice.
Yeah, the only pressure was when I said, yeah, I'm moving to Munich.
Yeah, there was. And I'll tell you what, though, I think if you hadn't have left the country in such a hurry, we'd still be finishing it now.
Yeah, sometimes you need a deadline.
Yeah, there's a risk in there. If you don't kind of decide that you're going to do it by this date and someone rides it hard, you can end up, I guess, mm-hmm. Procrastinate and keep tweaking bits and, you know, forever and a day.
Well, we did plenty of that as well, but yeah, I take your point, yeah.
So yeah, I'm a terrible perfectionist when it comes to the lyrics, particularly on this album. You know, this is one of the first albums that I've done where I've been really meticulous about the lyrics, where I had John up the wall, you know, just when he's been settled with and the song titles as well. Some of the song titles we had on there changed about 8 times. I'd lie awake at night just thinking of these lyrics and go, fuck, no, I've got a much better title. And I'd share it with the boys and they're all just like, yeah, whatever. And particularly Mark, I think he got quite confused being a drummer. He'd be like, well, what's this fucking song called again? It's like, mate, you don't need to worry about that.
it's just the one that starts 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, let's just get on with it.
I think if you've got 5 people in the band all piling ideas in and pulling every way, you never do it. You need a couple of people in the band to be in the driving seat and everyone else just to, you know, support that and take a little bit of a back seat. I mean, we all contribute with songwriting. We all put ideas in. We all listen to each other. I think, again, being older, that made a big difference. You know, no one's got any, as far as I know, no one's a dick, but that might be me.
I don't know, mate. Yeah, if you don't know the dick in the band, you know what they say. Yeah.
It's like if you can't spot the loony on the bus, it's you.
You're in. So what about the themes for the album? You know, Chris, you're kind of the main lyricist. Do they, you know, was there an intent to talk about certain things? Or is it just
sharks mainly, wasn't it, Chris? Sharks.
Well, do you know, I mean, one thing I was very intent of with the 4-way kill stuff, it got quite autobiographical in a lot of sense. And if you look at some of the 4-way kill lyrics, they're quite angry, quite depressing in certain senses, because that's kind of where I was at in my life at the time. There was a lot of shit going on, and it was reflected in my stage persona and the lyrics. Which worked in some sense and got out of hand in others. So, you know, it had been a long time since I've been in that space. So I was very intentional, and still am, of writing from a third party point of view on this album. I wanted to tell stories and I wanted to tell critiques and bring sort of a vision of the world that I saw it, or a vision of historical moments that as I'd read it. So I was very intentional about not involving myself in any of the songs or how I felt necessarily about things. And it's a thrash album. So a lot of the topics kind of wrote themselves, you know. Obviously, you know, the world's in a scary place again. You know, it wasn't when we were growing up, you know, that I think one of the reasons thrash metal was so attractive to me as a young boy was that, you know, it sung about the fears that I had, you know, the fears of imminent nuclear attack. You know, we lived through that in the 80s. Yeah. And maybe the fears have changed, but the actual threat is still there, you know, as as Mr. Mustaine says, you know, the threat is real. It's still there. And we've only got to look at the news this week with those fucking ridiculous images on Capitol Hill, you know. And that's just one country. That's just what we hear about because we're so far up America's arse in this country. It's all we seem to worry about. But there's so much other scary stuff going on. Atrocities against indigenous people and entire races of people. Still the imminent threat of war everywhere. Our obsession to just kill and hate each other as a species. So all these things came out in the lyrics. And also, you know, I'm really into First World War history. So there's some of that in there. Hung out to dry. It's just kind of a story of a young man waiting to go over the top, really. And just that image that we've all seen, you know, of the young boys in the trenches. And I think as metalheads, you know, we're quite a sensitive lot. You know, people from the outside who don't understand the metal scene and the thrash scene, they tend to think we're a bunch of meatheads, but we're not. You know, things like that upset us and piss us off and make us angry. So I think it was relevant to sing about it. And then as John said as well, on a lighter side, I always wanted to write a song about a fucking great shark. So there is a song on there about a fucking great shark, which is just good fun. Do you know what I mean? Exodus, you know, they've based their entire early career about writing songs about things that can kill you. So we thought we'd bung that on there. But yeah, and there's, you know, again, there's a few things on there about you know, the end times, about the apocalypse, about the sort of imminent demise of the human race. All jolly stuff, really. All stuff you can play to your granny.
Yeah. I think we tick all the boxes.
Yeah, and it's all pretty typical in that way. It's pretty typical thrash fare, isn't it? It's just, I guess, your approach to, you know, the information at hand and your awareness of the world is a lot different now than it was 30 odd years ago.
Yeah, I think so. Change. Yeah, I mean, there was a sort of ignorant naivety, I think, as teenagers. I mean, Purgatory, first time round, we got into trouble for a couple of songs that we had because we were a bunch of dicks, you know, we're just writing songs about, you'd hear something on the news, you'd say, I'm going to write a song about that. You know, we had a song on there, we had like it wasn't a pro-life song, but it was a song about abortions and stuff, and it was a bunch of stupid kids writing stupid song, you know. We had no fucking understanding about it and no right to even comment on that subject. And so we got in trouble about that. We had a song in there about euthanasia as well. Again, you know, now we're a bit older. If someone wanted to get rid of me when I was 72, I'd be a bit upset about it.
You've only got 20 odd years left.
We're all closing in on that. That's a bit too close to comfort now. Yeah, it's all right when you're 20, isn't it?
Exactly. But then, you know, part of that was because we were very much into the hardcore scene as well, and it was a bit of shock value. Do you know what I mean? It was a bit of a cue to the world. So, yeah, I think we're a bit older, a bit wiser now. Maybe the same things anger us, but we've got a bit more wisdom about actually what is real and what's not, I suppose. And what is our business and what isn't our business, you know? I've got no right to tell someone how to live their life and what they see as important may not be important to me. However, I've got every right in the world to comment and criticise about, you know, the state of the world.
Yeah. So that's obviously carried on to your it carried on to the art of the album and the single as well. So who came up with the concept of that? Did you just go to Sarge with some ideas and he got his digital sketchbook out, or you know, how much steering did he give him on that?
We sent him a fair amount of stuff, didn't we? We sent him all the lyrics and you sent him a big synopsis and stuff, and also ideas and stuff we liked, and we just said just go with it.
Yeah. I mean, we had a strong idea that we wanted it to look quite old school. We wanted it to look like a thrash album. Didn't want it too photographic. And you know, we wanted a central character. We didn't know who that central character was going to be. So, yeah, we certainly sent him some ideas. We said, look, you know, this we like the idea of a world leader addressing this sort of rabid mob. Whether the mob are his followers or whether they want to tear him to bits, you know, we'll leave that for the viewer to actually decide upon. And we love the idea of the fact that he's plugged into this mainframe, you know, of this sort of this massive sort of computer. It gives it that almost that sort of dystopian futuristic feel about it. Again, we didn't want to defer too much from the classic sort of thrash look and vibe about it, hence the big explosions and the melting buildings.
Yeah.
But regarding the single cover, I mean, John, you probably want to talk about that because that came about from you, didn't it?
Andy put the lyric video together, and we obviously saw it a few weeks before it came out, and we're like, yeah, we need a cover, really. So, we just took some of the images from that, and I blended it with the cover, and away we go. You know, it works well, I think.
Yeah, it does really well. Yeah,
that's what it says on the tin.
And Andy's a machine anyway, isn't he? His turnaround times are unbelievable.
Yeah. He thinks he's cornered the market for every UK metal band, doesn't he?
Well, yeah, I'm not sure he's only sticking to UK, isn't he? He's kind of the go-to guy for everyone when they're in a panic.
He certainly delivers. You know, it's really good. And the other thing, I talk about the recording process and everything else. I did all the engineering stuff and put the stuff together and all the edits and stuff. But in the end, we just went on Fiverr, didn't we? And we looked for someone who did metal mixing and mastering. And we found Widek, this guy from Poland. And we started chatting to him and stuff. And yeah, we just did it on a song by song basis. And again, he delivered, you know, through gritted teeth at some points, I'm sure. Well, what you want to do? How many echoes do you want on that bit? It really was in fine detail.
Four.
But
you never have more than four.
That's right. Yeah. You know, it worked because I didn't trust myself to be able to deliver something of the quality he's done. And you need someone with independent sort of sound production, you know, to be able to master it and mix it and stuff. And also I could say, look, we've only got three revisions, so that's it.
So did he do everything?
Basically I sent him all the stems. So I recorded all the vocals of Chris and did all the, basically just engineered the whole thing. I sent him the sort of raw WAV files and the MIDI parts and stuff and everything else. And he basically just turned into what it is now. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it felt like it was a little bit cheated just sending it off to this guy, but you know what, he sat there, he's in a full studio, so it's no different than just I think handing it over to someone that you've been working with the recording process. It just felt weird never actually meeting him.
Yeah,
I think that's the thing I had to get my head around, the fact that the world is a lot smaller place now, you know, and a lot of bands don't even live in the same country anymore, let alone, you know, record in the same country. So it was a wake-up call for me personally, just having to you know, get out of that old school mindset of like, you know, and I think a couple of the other members as well. Mark took a while to get his head around the fact, as I say, of just like not using an acoustic kit necessarily, and things like that, and not having a wall of Marshalls when we're recording. You know, I think the guitars went straight DI'd into the.
I mean, basically they're all reamped, basically, so you know they all sent off dry. Yeah, it sounds terrible when you look at the original stuff. You know, but yeah, I mean, I was doing rough mixes, on my kit and stuff, just so we were happy with the song structures and everything else, and everything was there that should be there. And then at that point we then, you know, basically package it up, send it off, first mix come back, yes, maybe, no, whatever, and just do it. So it was a long process, but you know, that's what albums have to be these days. You know, you have to be incredibly detailed. You're conscious of the detail, really. Yeah. Otherwise, it's going to bug you forever.
Yeah.
I wish I'd done that.
And what about when you have to go and replicate that live now? You know, we are
fucked.
Yeah, I need to go and invest in 10 million quid's worth of kit so I can sound the same. Yeah.
Exactly. Well, 2 points. One, no one's gigging anyway at the moment. And two, let's just cross that bridge when we come to it, eh?
I mean, the original idea with this album was it was only ever going to be a studio project. Even when we all got together, you know, it was kind of like none of us really had the desire to go out sleeping in a van again. But then it became apparent quite quickly, do you know what, this is metal and it needs to be played live. So we did make the decision that we are going to look at doing some gigs. As John said, we don't need to worry about it at the moment. But we won't be taking it out on the road for weeks on end, sleeping in the van every weekend. You know, we've all got families and we've all got we've all got jobs that we got to pay for the bills, etc. But certainly we're hoping to play a couple of high-profile festivals and some warm-up gigs and stuff like that, you know?
Yeah.
And when we get round to doing that, yeah, it's going to be interesting. But again, with modern technology, you know, we'll be able to rehearse without John. John will be able to learn the songs at home. We can all learn the songs at home, you know? I'm planning having a full recording of all the songs with no vocals on, so I can just go into a little rehearsal studio on my own here and just bang them out.
Yeah.
And there's even talk as well about maybe digging up a couple of the old Purgatory numbers from way back and adding them into a live set as well, which would be quite exciting.
I was going to ask that. I was going to ask how many of those original demos and the Demon LP were going to make it back from the grave.
I don't know any of them.
Yeah, I think that'd be
better get learning, John. You're going to have to do it in a minute.
Because none of it is recorded to a click. None of it is recorded to a click track, so the tempos wander all over the place. We'd no way to be. We would never be able to recreate that digitally anyway.
Well, that was the joy of it, wasn't it? I don't think there's a nuclear assault song that's ever played the same speed as that.
No.
I love them so much. But yeah, we're going to dig out a couple. I mean, there's been talk of doing Left for Dead, which was the very first song that we ever wrote in Purgatory. It's quite a naive thrash metal song. It's quite a naive subject matter. It's obviously written by a bunch of kids who were very much into Metallica at the time. But it's a good. It still stands up, you know. A couple of little tweaks. It could be a real great live number. Mm. And I think we'll probably maybe look at Better Off Dead. But I might have to tweak the lyrics a bit to that.
I mean, one thing we did say was "Hung Out to Die," or the first main track off the new album, is kind of old school, and it kind of links with Purgatory quite nicely, doesn't it, Chris? Do you think?
Yeah, I think so. I think it was the first song we wrote for the album, wasn't it? So I think the mindset was still very much in it was going to be a Purgatory album. So we wrote that, and yeah, absolutely, that could be quite easily lifted off an old Purgatory demo, and it was kind of quite cathartic doing that. It was kind of like, okay, we got this out of our system, we can still do the Purgatory stuff. Now, where are we going to take this? Are we going to stick to a blueprint, stick to a formula, or are we just going to fucking write how it feels? So we decided just to write how it feels. So I think that's what's made the album quite a journey. It's quite eclectic. It's the backbone is a thrash album, but it does go off on tangents. You know, there's a lot of light and shade in there. So we started the album with this full on thrasher that gets you in the mood. Said, right, we're nailing our flag to the mast. These are our colours. However, we're going to take you on a little bit of a journey now because it's been a long time since we did that first time round. You know.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's definitely, you know, I mean, I've had it on quite a bit since you sent me a copy over, and it is thrash, you know. There's no kind of untying it from the thrash tether, but it's not a raw naive thrash metal album. It's a thrash metal album for today. It's got those, you know, those modern sounds in there, and the, as you say,
the female singer.
Yeah, so she's from, is it Meta Prison?
Yes, Teresa? She is. Yes,
yeah.
How did that come about? That was an interesting time, wasn't it, Chris? It was an easier sell for me because obviously I've been in Mercury Rain and we had a female singer. That's no problem for me.
Still a couple of members of the band that are living in denial. They're in trumpet, aren't they? No, I refuse to accept. We have a female singer.
it was a bit of a hard sell, but I think I just put my foot down. So no, I mean, it was Jock's idea originally. He mentioned it casually. I said, yeah, that's a great idea. Once Chris is on board, he's like, well, that's 3/5 of us want it. Let's have it. So, but no, she was great. I think she's done a great. I mean, none of us have ever met her. It's all done remotely again.
Breeza Smith. She's amazing. And she's just got this presence and she knows her voice as well. And a lot of women singers nowadays are either trying to sound like men or don't quite know their voice. And she's just really good. So it was quite interesting because when we spoke about it, John and I, she was the first name that came up. I said, look, the only person I could think of that could do it is Teresa from Metaprism. And it's like, well, none of us fucking know her. So, of course, again, the world's a small place. So she agreed to do it. She's got her own home studio set up. She did her vocals in her place. But I think it came around because John and I we just finished doing some recording for a couple of the tracks. And I had this lyrics for Beyond the Rubicon. I really wanted to do this song because I really love the title and the concept of it. So we started playing with an existing riff that we had. And I did this chorus and started experimenting on this chorus, and it almost came out Priest-like. It was almost a bit of Rob Halford vibe to it, because I sing in a couple of different octaves, a couple of different keys on the chorus, and it gave it a kind of weird Rob Halford vibe about it. And when we played it back, I think it was Jock, wasn't it, John?
Yeah, it was. He said,
we need a female backing singer on this. And I was like, you're fucking joking, aren't you? I'll tell you what made me feel all right about it, and that was Megadeth. I thought, if they can do it, I'm happy.
Yeah. We'll have a bit of that.
but that reminds me. I mean, obviously,
I was going to say, we
actually did it the other way around. You guessed it on one of the Mercury Rain songs back in the day, didn't you? Back in 2004.
Yeah, it did.
You know, so it was kind of nice to flip that round, really.
Yeah, absolutely. And it felt like a risk, you know, it still does. And I think part of me is still waiting for someone to turn around and say, what the fuck is that? You know, that's not thrash metal or whatever. But I think it works, you know, it's quite a brutal song. It's brooding. It's not 100,000 miles an hour, but I just think it lifts the chorus and it works, you know.
Well, what did you think when you heard that, Neil? Were you surprised? Because there's no, you weren't expecting it, presumably.
No, I was surprised, but not in a negative way. You know, I'd have been more upset if you'd started banging in a bit of metalcore in the middle or gone all genty or something in there. You know, so like the new Ultraviolet single. Oh no, we're not allowed to mention it. But you know, there's kind of, you know, it's still thrash. You know, there's some great female fronted thrash bands, Nervosa, you know, unbelievable. It wasn't what I expected, but as I said, it wasn't a, oh, fucking hell, what are they doing? You know, sellouts, fucking, you know, whatever. It was just, it was just a fucking hell. That's a, you know, cool to take a risk. And Gareth, the guy who did the review for the Demon Side, but, you know, he was, you know, he's been listening to the whole album as well. And he's going, that duet with Teresa's brilliant. He goes, that's a real kind of standout, you know, of doing something different and taking a bit of a risk. And
cool,
you
know, good.
That's good to hear, because it was a risk. And as I say, it all comes back to the fact that, you know, we got nothing to prove on this album. You know, we're all quite comfortable with the writing and the direction it's taken. So it was just stepping out on the ice a little bit, which was a bit scary. But again, as you say, it's like, what's the worst that can happen? Someone don't like it. Fuck them.
Some prick on the internet calls you out on it. Yeah,
it's only going to hurt our wallets.
Yeah, yeah. I was going to say it's only you paying for everything at the minute. So you know.
Exactly.
So talking about pricks on the internet, what do you kind of think about the UK scene at the moment? Yeah, you know, what do you look at all the young bands and, you know, look at the new wave of stuff? Are you still listening to thrash of the, you know, this generation? Those of them, you know, those produced by kids that weren't even a twinkle in their father's eyes when you were doing it first time round.
Definitely. I think the current scene. I think the UK scene has never been unhealthy. Particularly the thrash scene. The thrash scene's never gone away. I mean, a lot of bands about 10 years ago suddenly made it cool. Personally speaking, I loved it when denim cutoffs came back in and everyone started wearing patches again, you know, bullet belts. I can bring it on, you know. I love the smell of patchouli oil, and it's really, I find it really exciting seeing young bands, as you say, you weren't even around when the first wave of thrash was out there, are running around with their patches on and they all want to make music, because that's what it's about. I mean, there's no other genre like metal where so many of your mates are in bands. You know, everyone wants to make music, and it's not because we want to be fucking rock stars. It's just because there's that connection immediately, that energy. And to see these young kids, he said, with a patronizing old man smirk, these young kids coming up and just writing some incredible music. It's outstanding. I love it. You know, and there's a lot of really good British bands coming up at the moment. I mean, and American bands as well, you know. I mean, I'm really into Warbringer recently. You know, they're incredible.
Yeah.
And of course the... you know, and also a lot of not what you necessarily call thrash, but just some really good traditional metal bands coming over, like, you know, Riot City. You know, you listen to their album and Paladin. I mean, that Paladin album, again, there's some amazing thrash guitar work on that. And these guys are sort of in their early 20s. You know, it's fantastic to hear. It really is. And I think festivals like Bloodstock are really good for that as well. You know, you've only got to step in the New Blood tent there and just see some phenomenal stuff going on.
Yeah, that metal to the masses thing has been a real, you know, a real blessing to you know, people making music, you know, that ability to do a local gig and get voted through by your peers and end up on the stage at Bloodstock, I think it's an amazing, you know, it's an amazing legacy from the Bloodstock team, really, that.
Yeah, I mean, we were, you know, into Bloodstock pretty, what, the year after it started? When was the first Bloodstock, Chris? 2001, wasn't it?
2001, so
we were,
wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, we played 2003, so it was still indoors. It was early days. Vince was running it, and, you know, it was an amazing opportunity. I mean, we opened the main stage, and Nightwish headlined it. It was like, you know, dream come true sort of thing, you know? It was amazing. You know, I mean, that's my background. It's more the sort of gothic stuff, you know, you're Paralyzed Lost, you know, yeah, the sort of the gothic side of stuff, you know, and hopefully that's brought some of that to this album, and I think it works, you know.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we've all got different influences. Mark is very much into your sort of Napalm Death, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
That is certainly more on the heavy side. What about Jason and Jock? What's Jock? Jock likes Frankie Goes to Hollywood, I think.
He'll love you for that, mate.
Relax.
I think that was his wife.
Yeah, he says that.
You can't play the guitar because you're fucking wife. Yeah.
I mean, that's the only thing. I suppose you talk to, yeah, you know, you see kids and young kids about, and they don't get the Spinal Tap or the Bad News references, whereas we all do.
Yeah, there's a whole, yeah, absolutely. There's a whole community, isn't there, of metalheads. So you've only got to say one line from Bad News out, and everyone just starts smirking.
We've never grown up emotionally, have we?
Well, no, I think that's heavy metal, full stop, isn't it?
Yeah, that's it. My missus keeps telling people I'm not having a midlife crisis. I've just never fucking grown up. So I think that's probably pretty similar for all of us.
Yeah. I think my parents are still waiting for me to grow out of my heavy metal phase.
That's it. Yeah, don't worry. It's just the phase he's going through. Nope.
I remember that being spoken over me when I was about 12, living in a little village. Oh, you'll grow out of it. I remember at the time thinking, I fucking won't.
Yeah, I think you proved them. You think you proved the point, mate. You can stop now.
Yeah, you can let it go now. Yeah. Yeah. The single came out Christmas Day.
Yeah, happy Christmas.
It was Happy Christmas. Yeah,
so you're welcome.
I was just checking. How's it been received? On you know, you've been getting plenty of plays, plenty of positive feedback.
Yeah. It seems to be. I mean, well, again, we've all got a lot of contacts in the industry and stuff, and speaking to guys there, and they're saying one thing lockdown's done is, I mean, everyone is recording stuff and everyone is releasing stuff. So there's a lot of stuff out there, and it's hard to make your voice heard, really. But everyone who's heard it, apart from one or two people, has liked it. But again, it's a whole learning curve for us, you know, promoting stuff on Facebook and Instagram and all that kind of stuff is all relatively new for us, you know.
Instagram, you haven't done a post yet. What are you talking about?
I know. Yeah, I knew you picked up on that.
Gentle response.
I only found out last week that you can't actually post anything from Instagram on a desktop PC. So I'm fucked.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, no, that's not even my department.
I haven't got any photos on my phone other than the kids, and they're not really going to work, is it?
No.
One thing that's quite exciting about the response with the single is, the whole idea of the single was it was to whet people's appetites, really, and it was to give Andy something to do with it with a video. We were really keen with the lyric video.
Yeah.
And of course, a lot of the songs on the album, unintentionally, are quite long. So we kind of it wasn't written for a single release as such, but we purposely wrote that song because we needed something a bit short and sharp. And it's still 4 minutes, so it's not too short. And so it was quite a surprise when it was like, well, the single's going to be Demonicide. We were like, oh, wow, we didn't really expect it to be, but it just kind of happened.
That's but the general much the sort of last one we did, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think it was. What I like about it is lots of people have said, great, love it, but I'm waiting for the album. And that's really good because I think that's what it's all about, isn't it, really? The whole genre of metal and thrash metal, it's not about getting single clicks. It's not about getting casual listeners. You know, it's about people who live and breathe this stuff and are invested in it, and they will buy the album and they will stick it on their shelf and they will download it into the car, you know, and blast it out and get to know the album. And that's what I've always done, and that's what I still think metalheads do today. So there's been a nice anticipation for the full album. So we're hoping it's gonna make a lot of people happy. Also releasing it on Christmas Day means that you all owe us a Christmas present, so that's quite good.
Yeah, it was an excuse not to listen to the family for a couple of hours. Yeah, just play that on repeat. So what about the what's the details for the rest of the release? I did read it on Facebook the other day, but do you want to let people know how you're going to do the full album release?
Yeah, let's go. So we're basically waiting on Andy at the moment to finish the booklet for the artwork, and then we're going to get a limited rundown of physical CDs, and they'll be available through Bandcamp. And I think we're looking at actually releasing that and probably shipping it end of February, something like that. Just give us a bit of time, to sort of make sure it's all done and correct and everything else. But no, the digital release pre-orders on the 15th of January, and then it's coming out on the 29th, I think.
Yeah, I believe
and
so.
What I like about Bandcamp is if you do order the physical CD at the end of January, then you get the digital file straight away.
Or as soon as it's released,
So, you know, as soon as it's released. So, yeah, you can download and play it, and then the CD turns up in the post, you know, a month or so later.
Yeah.
Bandcamp's
my go-to place, really. I think it's an amazing platform for musicians, and, you know, they don't rip you off too much with regards to how much their commission is and all that sort of stuff. So it's a great bit of kit.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, it's just moving with the time, isn't it? It's a fantastic platform, as you say. You know, gone are the times of having to, lug your CD around. I mean, in an ideal world, we'd be playing gigs which we could sell it at. But the Bandcamp is brilliant. Yeah, I use it myself because, you know, the money's going straight to the band, you know?
So I was going to say, I did the charity compilation album last year. And I wrote to them. They upgraded me straight away. So they take, off anything I sell, they take less commission. You know, so they've been doing all the Bandcamp Fridays to look after musicians. You couldn't imagine Spotify doing that, can you? Yeah, let's have a day and we'll pay all the musicians what they've made for us.
Yeah, so, I love it. They've been doing that. It's really good.
Yeah, Spotify is a real difficult one because, you know, it's a massive platform, Spotify, and you kind of got to be on there, but you know that you're not going to get anything back from it.
Yeah,
you know, it's a free
marketing platform, isn't it? That's what you get out of it.
Basically, yeah. I mean, I still go and buy CDs from bands because I necessarily need it to get the music, but because I want to support the band.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's important to do that. And if I want bands to keep going and producing music I like, then I need to support that.
Definitely. And I did a bit of research before we decided the format, what we were going to release in. I just did a bit of research on one of the forums. And just said, look, you know, how do you buy your music? You know, and the amount of people that bought physical CDs was just, you know, phenomenal. It was just it was sort of 60-70%. And most people agreed that they will stream to sort of find new music.
Yeah.
And then if they like it, they'll buy the CD, which is kind of like what I do, really, to be honest. And I think Spotify and other formats like that, I think that's what they're fantastic for. You know, I've discovered like tons of bands since having Spotify, you know, and so I think you've got to work with it, haven't you? I think as a promotional tool and as in a way of discovering bands, because gone are the days where we'd all sit up late and listen to the Friday rock show.
Yeah.
Those of you under the age of 40.
Yeah, cultural reference there.
Do you know what I mean? Those days are gone. We can't all wait for Tommy Vance to tell us what to listen to. So, Spotify is brilliant for that.
And also kind of going in the record shop and flicking through. You know, I used to stand in my local record shop in Coventry where I grew up. I used to stand in the record shop going through the, you know, metal albums. Cracking one off over the covers. You know, fucking hell. I don't know what the band sounds like, but the cover's awesome. I'm having that. You know, there's a few horrors in my collection.
Yeah, I've fallen foul of that. Great artwork talking about the album. Yeah.
I did a couple of them. I remember that. I still got to have a word with Dream Death.
About that album. We signed up with a service called DistroKid, which is I don't know if you've heard of it, Neil. It's one of those, you basically sign up and they will basically submit it and get it onto Amazon, iTunes, Spotify, the whole lot for a really reasonable annual fee, so we've done it that way. And that means, we're on, Deezer and all the, it's about 30 odd platforms. So, you know, you can't hope, whatever you used to listen to music, you should be able to find us on there somewhere.
And fucking miss it.
However hard you try, you're not going to miss it anywhere. What about merch? Pat, you just spoke about all the kids in the demo. Can we have some patches, please?
Oh, mate, do you know what? I've been looking into it. I'm a right patch collector.
Oh, yeah. He's not lying, Neil. He's not lying.
Yeah, we will at some point have some patches. I don't think they'll be exactly what I want because, you know, it's bloody cost a fortune.
It's fucking
patches.
Expensive, isn't it?
It's cheaper to get T-shirts.
Yeah.
But, we're currently actually in negotiation with a couple of artists at the moment to come up with T-shirt design. We're going to have some merch. Probably around Easter time, we're going to get a few T-shirts done, see how they go. Again, fortunately, we found a company in Bristol actually who can do some quite short runs for us, so we can keep it kind of all in-house and just get a short run, hopefully knock them out and then get another run. But patch, nice colour embroidered patches would go well, wouldn't they?
Yeah,
don't give him ideas, Neil.
There's a company. The company.
You've already like spent the budget cover, about 10 times.
Full album cover.
There's a company in Bristol.
Full album cover.
No, logo. It's all about the logo patch. That's all.
Yeah, it is, Daddy. I'm still old school. I like the patch where you can't even see what the album is because there's so much detail on it.
That's it. 3,000 pixels per inch crammed into a kind of 10 centimeter square patch. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the one.
That's what you want. That's the one.
Blur of colour.
Okay, kind of finally, anything else? Pimp yourselves out. Where do we find you socially? What's your Bandcamp address and all that other good stuff?
We've got old school and actually got our website. We've actually got trappedinpurgatory.com.
I saw that.
Yeah, do you know what? I was like, well,
MySpace account next.
MySpace, yeah, fucking hell. Well, again, since I moved abroad and had nothing to do, it's like, well, I might as well just do a website. So yeah, I just put that together, and it's like, well, okay, it's not the first place people look, but it gives credibility to a band, you know.
It's quite useful as a hobby.
Yeah, I think it's been.
So yeah, we've got obviously Spotify, obviously Facebook, a very sparse Instagram account. Even though people are following us for some reason, we've never posted anything. But when it comes, it'd be amazing.
I might start posting random bollocks. Make a little Trump account.
Thanks very much, mate. That'd be awesome. it's good. I mean, as I say, I just go back. I mean, it's a world away from when we both started, really.
Mm.
It's a phenomenal thing.
I remember getting the first MySpace account with Four Way Kill, and it was just like, yeah, this is completely blowing my mind.
Well, as I say, the whole recording process, I know it was a bit of a change, especially for you. I mean, it's the way I'd always worked, so yeah. I was happy to sort of do it like that. But I think the results speak for themselves. I'm really proud of it. There's not many albums that I've been involved with I can go back and listen to.
Yeah.
Because I think, I wish I'd done that. I wish I'd done this. But yeah, I listen to it every couple of days and I'm still happy with it. So that's amazing to me.
Absolutely. We are all really proud of the product. And I think for me, a test of that is that I'm already writing stuff for the next one, and this is coming out. We're talking about, hopefully doing something, maybe an EP of a cover version. I can't tell you what the cover would be yet, but we went proper old school thrash style and drew back an old 80s pop song. So we're going to give that a Trapped in Purgatory makeover. That'll see the light of day. That'd be great. And I just want to say it's not Ghostbusters.
It's not the Frankie Goes to Hollywood reference then.
He's good, isn't he?
He's good, isn't he? He's like, you've done this before. Yeah, I'm still not sure about the power of love, but we'll give it a go.
Hey, mate, it's all right. The power of trash.
We're talking about doing it because we've got some artwork that we originally had done for this album. Which lends itself to what we're going to be doing, but it's like, well, it'd be a shame not to use that. So yeah, really, we're doing it arse about face, and we've got the artwork. We might as well do something to go with it, you know. Yeah.
That'd make a good T-shirt. Quick, write a song.
Yeah, write something about it. Hey, whatever.
But yeah,
whatever
again, works. I mean, the whole thing was a slow evolution. We started off with this artwork that we had done, and it fitted what we were doing. And then 6 months in, I just like, do you know what? I think the stuff we're doing is the quality of what we're producing doesn't match with the artwork. You know, we need to spend some time, effort and money on this to bring it all up to scratch,
Yeah, it's brought it all together, isn't it? And I think people, well, I'm hoping people will see that. I'm hoping, because we're going to have a full 12-page booklet with the CD. You know, I encourage people to buy the physical CD because we're spending a lot of time and effort on that. All the lyrics will be in there, you know, photos, and they say Andy's going to do his lovely magic there with all the sort of backgrounds and stuff. So, you know, we're spending some time on it. It's going to be a nice product to actually own, rather than just have the music, you know. And I think that's important. Again, that goes back, I think, to just growing up, buying those albums, you know, buying those albums with the great covers and all the detail and stuff. You know, I'd love to do a vinyl pressing, but at the moment that's not possible.
God, it's
possible, but you'd be paying for it yourself.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's expensive, and the lead time's horrendous as well, isn't it? I was talking to the guys I use at Cram Duplication the other week, and there's a, you know, you're looking at a 3 or 4 month lead time for vinyl press at the minute.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's fantastic. And just, you know, we're talking about, you know, getting music out there and stuff. And not, you know, I don't want to take anything away from what you do as well, and people like you, you know, getting these blogs up online and just running sites for the sheer passion of it, you know. And I think that's another great thing about metal, is the fact that, you know, the fans are prepared to actually get up and share with the world what they love, which is what you're doing.
Yeah, hang on, I paid him £400 for this. What are you on about? Yeah.
check
he's getting a fucking CD, is he?
No. It is. I mean, but metal's always been about a fan culture and fan support, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, 100%. And beer. You know, and beer, yeah. And it, you know.
Saying that, both Chris and I are teetotal, so even though I live in the beer capital of Europe, I don't really drink.
I drank my fill in the
90s. I know. I feel I ought to start drinking again just to blend in with the locals.
Yeah, at least for Oktoberfest.
You know what? I was watching the Vacuum movie, the latest one, the 3D one. I was watching the other day. Great film, man. Really good. And I was watching it and I was thinking, God, I really miss Vacuum. It's such a great festival. But it is so much about the beer. Being where I'm at now, I don't think I could spend a weekend with 80,000 Germans getting pissed. It would fucking kill me just to sit there watching them. So I leave others to do my drinking for me these days.
There's always someone willing to step into the breach. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm looking at you, Rod Boston.
But I think as you get older and you have kids and stuff, you know, the need to go out and get absolutely fucking shit-faced, it diminishes, you know. I don't miss it at all.
Well, I remember the first gig I went to sober for many, many, many years was Motorhead in 2011. And I remember texting my mate, Martin, who we used to go to Motorhead with every year religiously. We'd make a big weekend of it. And I remember texting him going, I didn't know Nicky D did a fucking drum solo.
You never got that far.
It's because you're always in the toilets, you fucking animal.
And it's so fucking expensive at the moment as well, isn't it? These days. And £5 a pint and stuff. Said, geez, how can you afford to go out these days, you know?
Spoken like a true middle-aged man.
I know. Did you know?
But how many seconds can afford it?
In the price of these.
How are they going to buy our album if they're spending that money on beer?
Yeah, exactly.
I know. It's a bargain, yeah. I'm only looking at a pint.
Do you not sneak a bottle of Mad Dog 2020?
Going to brewing beer. Oh, yeah, man. Mad Dog 2020, that you're talking. Guys, and a scrumpy at Bennington.
Oh, God. Yeah, of course, because you're a good Bristolian lad, so you'll be fucking filtering apples through your teeth.
Yeah. Gallon of scrumpy. That was great. And then halfway through the day, it doubled as a toilet.
Oh, God. And thrown over the top of the crowd here. Guys, on that note, I'm going to let you go. Really good luck with the album. As I said, we've been enjoying it while we've been doing the review, which is going to be up probably tonight, actually. Look forward to it. I hope to see you live somewhere. Good luck going forward.
Brilliant. Thanks, Neil. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thanks to everyone for listening. And keep the faith. See you soon.
Nice one. Brilliant. Thanks, Neil.
That was Trapped in Purgatory. Their new album, Damned Nation, goes on pre-sale today. In the meantime, we've got an exclusive. This is also from that new album. This is Patient Zero. Massive thanks to the guys in Trapped by Purgatory for joining us on the show, and of course letting us play that track in advance of the album coming out. Okay, next up is our overseas band of the week. This is from the USA. This is First Strike and their track Ripped to Shreds. Okay, that was First Strike, and you may have noticed a bit of an old school vibe about that. That's because that track was actually recorded back in 1988. The band are back together. Guitarist Paulie, who's actually from Brighton originally, is back in the studio. They've all reformed and are putting out new material soon. Hopefully we'll have them on the show in the coming weeks. Okay, next up is our final track of the episode. This is Sorticide. If it bleeds, we can kill it. That's it. Episode 1 of Season 3 is done and dusted. Thank you for joining us. Keep an eye on all our social feeds and see you next time.